Truth before the truth. Coffee, the virgin mind, and anti-mutagenic pathways. This rationalization here is not self-deceptive if you get the point. The background music is Jesse Cook. I usually listen to metal during a cup of coffee. Sharing my thoughts, I ask myself, what would I play if I made coffee for more than one? Jesse Cook, y'all. This is some focus from me using coffee as my example of the situation the whole world's victims of. The claim is coffee is good or bad as it has positive and negative effects. This may seem as if I'm canceling, but let's take a closer look. A much closer look at what this all involves. Out of all the possible combinations of foods we have without frequent fasting, they all clog the system in some way or another. But why? Atlas chucked the world on top of us and said, "You see how it feels. You knew we have something in common." Internally clogged makes you late for your biological clock's expectancy. You expect you here doing this, not needing to go through that. We live in a timing world fitting within schedules. Our biological clocks don't tick to the beat of nature's drum. Not the worst thing is we are conscious animals. All the stresses we are born into causes lots of stress. Each come from a long list of actions you choose from to take. If choosing is what you randomly pick or assume it the best option. I assume the claim of coffee to be correct, knowing all the foods this global economy provides isn't enough. The daily schedule forces repetition, denying the time to have the consciousness to select when and what to eat. Limited time and inabilities adding to the stress constrict your system because you are overwhelmed knowing you are or not. There is no one that isn't bothered. And around the world, a cup of coffee is the most popular way to let go of what you don't want to hold on to. What else is causing you to resort to a cup of coffee? There is a burden lifted when deciding to drink a cup that suggests to you to drink a cup. It feels good a little when you do. My speculation of it says the unwanted stress along with food you are provided to work with cause mutation. Using the term mutation defined by me as an uncertain direction of growth that leads to an abnormality or dysfunction that eventually disables your system, that being a particular mutation. Behind that, there are also disabilities we haven't identified that don't signify you as a crippled citizen. Meaning there are too many illnesses, diseases, retardations, and permanent disabilities to begin listing curable disabilities that could be identified in this world without all of the sickness in the world. Assuming we notify everyone about the largest hazardous effects of the world, people as a whole not prioritized isn't the only excuse we have for disabling ourselves. Inability needs enablers to get to the point of realizing what is and how to begin prioritizing. The coffee, black for me, cancels mutations that would begin to happen without an anti-mutagenic beverage. Learning to starve is an option that doesn't allow mutation as much, but a full belly pauses many stress factors while you absolve to absorb and digest and replenish. As coffee allows you to eat food that helps you sustain self, some of us begin using our brains at a more constant rate within the repetition of the same day over and over again. You've seen the movies Boss Level, Groundhog Day, and there's an episode of TNT's Librarians, etc. We all repeat the same day forever until the day is solved. If you're narcissistic, you're the one to beat it. We as humans aren't attempting to evolve to claim what is good or bad with small issues such as coffee, while the bigger picture problems are sources of strife and pain that isn't your fault, but our fault. Sure, coffee can be a problem, but it's also an enabler. Submission to the larger problems makes something that may not be a problem a problem. So there's a difference between coffee drinkers. Younger people are stimulated by the body panicking as the reaction to the coffee. I did this my first year drinking coffee. The increased heart rate is the rebellion and unconscious aggression against the momentary forced relaxation immediately after you drink at least half a cup. You get jittery, excited, or uppity as a result from this rebellion that you find likable. Likable because you've cut off the biological clock again and embraced the now instead of yesterday into tomorrow. If you can accept what you are doing or what you need to do, a cup of coffee will help. If you can't, it doesn't help you and you'll become imbalanced and excited for nothing. Fueled by the natural panic fighting the offsetting, we are told this is caffeine, a stimulant or upper opposed to a downer. Caffeine ingested describes this anatomically dealt with as it lasts 4 to 12 hours. If caffeine gives you energy, it wouldn't be an endurance stimulant due to the fact your overall constriction eased triggers increased blood pressure to balance it. If caffeine is energy, then it would have calories and help you gain strength in activities. Although you can gain strength with caffeine, but not as much without unless you train yourself to utilize it with habit, just as you do with anything else that's part of your intake. In habit, the first effect wears out or it gets better. In habit, the first effect wears out or gets better. This is caffeine on Wikipedia. Caffeine is a central nervous system stimulant of the methylxanthine class. It is the world's most widely consumed psychoactive drug. Unlike many other psychoactive substances, it is legal and unregulated in nearly all parts of the world. There are several known mechanisms of action to explain the effects of caffeine. The most prominent is that it reversibly blocks the action of adenosine on its receptors and consequently prevents the onset of drowsiness induced by adenosine. Caffeine also stimulates certain portions of the autonomic nervous system. They call caffeine a drug, although coffee isn't a food or drug. Scientists tell us that the brain-blood barrier passage opens more with caffeine. Or is it the central nervous system stimulated? Either or both ways, it describes you becoming open. Forced to repeat ourselves in any path we take without financial freedom to astray from the grind, coffee as well as other things stop you to go again. If you think a non-caloric warm beverage is a food or drug instead of a cup of coffee, then you assume that you can consume and go without any intervals between. Why? Everything you intake is excreted, filtering through you, similar to inhaling and exhaling breath. If you don't notice the interval that you wouldn't have had without the coffee, then you are only doing what available science tells you it does. Your body does things by its response to everything. Coffee is an interruption. When not interrupted, the interruption lets you end your own developed unconscious tolerance of the world and gives you a stronger than usual instinctive moment, similar to a psychedelic drug causing deep gnosis intuitions, however that may occur. A psychoactive substance means psychoactivity. Whatever activity you do is what coffee is helping you do. We're all psychotics repeating the huge mistake over and over again. And so psychology is a mainstream institution gnosis. Some prove us to be wrong by identification through the mental process. The others prove it by doing wrong only. The psycho in you is active after a cup. If working is what you do with coffee, then it helps you to accept the situation instead of becoming miserable. Why else do you select the coffee? Mutation isn't growth. Mutation happens when you don't heed the warnings and continue to attempt growth. Not miserable with coffee gives more evidence it's anti-mutagenic. I, for one, drugs don't feel good if you pay attention. Repeating, you should possess the foresight to sense with trepidation any mutations. Your body, without using the mental process, not notifying you, just does it if you begin to know it or not. Recognize. As a mutation is permanent, unless it happens overnight in sleep, you should feel the mutagens, knowing or not knowing. Mutagens lead to cancer, and cancer means you didn't sense it happening. Cancer isn't a witch's curse. Poof, a hole of suspended erosion. No, it began somewhere to claim its territory in you. Evidence of mutagens in sobriety, or what you consider sobriety, speaking mercifully, is any progress that isn't in lane towards maintaining a consistent, better body-regulated homeostasis. Why aren't you on your way if you are sober? Formation of mass that isn't a possible extension without it being anything but a burden after formed. Mutants are the exceptional who mutated and have these powers that don't burden them anywhere but outcasting them from the public. That's not us. Mutation isn't a trait. It is an unconscious, if not a daring, consciously stupid attempt to gain that is zapped like a moth to flame by your own total immunity to mutation itself. The immune system is how you cancel strange things from happening within you. If a mammal isn't immune to mutation itself, then one meal would grow third arms, then fourth and fifth hands, and our diversity would consist of physiological mutations. Not encouraging you to delete someone's immune system so you can grow monsters. What would life be without mutation as a possibility? I'm not trying to think of that, but it sounds like a good movie. Mutational direction in life is cut off slightly, a little, just enough from coffee to allow some clarity, unconscious or conscious, that immediately changes your immune system, shifting it into trepidation mode, not allowing your mutational direction in life to be assumed correct because you have to work. If you don't plan to change direction, then it helps you endure. Face it, none of us are going somewhere. The coffee won't do it forever without careful utilization. Try it all, why don't you? Mutagenia is a new term I'm using for a more precise determination of consumer culture's defectivity. What each person does when giving in completely to whatever consumer culture provides them describes mutagenia and its mutageniacs, like hysteria and those who are hysterical. Like hysteria and those who are hysterical. Instead of traits gained, mass total is accumulated. That leads to mutation defining our impairments. We have mutagens inside of us that, if successful, lead to a mutation. The mutation is then diagnosed by a physician with a particular name, labeling your specific dysfunction. There we have only permanent injury being the decision to give you compensation for having mutagenia and assuming it as life. The price you pay. Not saying all of this isn't a choice, but if you look, we haven't defined the inability to obey the immune system as a disease, retardation, or genetical trait for whatever makes that good. Coffee, also considered a drug because of addiction, but addiction and drugs do not mix together. They combine or stay separate. So why are they all addicted to a drug? The drug or coffee led the user to a moment of anti-mutagenic victory. The drug or coffee led the user to a moment of anti-mutagenic victory. And at that moment, your body remembers that you achieved a better state of being than before. Not a reward, but advancing in the game. Sad that lethal drugs are popular because it tears the user apart, although they don't know that's good for them. Then, that means their love for mutagenic pathways needs to be stopped. At that moment, the feel of joy happens. You feel aware. Not aware, but feel like you're almost there. Then you want that again and again, although it only showed you what you want and perhaps need. A load off from all the mutagens you hold on to. Calling coffee a diuretic is describing your body purge the excess. Is it helping you purge the excess or let the excess go? Either way, are we against our own immune systems, making a cup of coffee our immunity?